You wanna?
Yeah.
Like do the thing? Cause I'm gonna turn that thing on.
And I will tell you, our laptop has the sound in the bucket.
Oh.
So we have to go power on.
Okay.
And I'm very fine.
Uh-oh. Am I plugged in?
I shake that.
What's on the power?
Uh-oh, is it, make sure the power strip is,
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh.
Oh, you didn't see me.
She's looking at me like I'm crazy.
That's a technical problem.
Okay, well, while we're stopping technical.
Sorry.
Okay. I'll call meeting to order. This is the March 1st meeting of the Valdosta Lowndes County Zoning Board of Appeals. Welcome. The way things generally work here is staff will present our case. We have just one case today. And then we'll hear from the staff, and if we have any questions, we'll ask her any questions we have. Then we'll hear from anybody who's in favor. And then we'll hear from anybody that's Alan. Anybody who's in opposition, and then we'll discuss, and then generally we make a decision today, but the board does have the possibility to table until the next meeting. Here's our chairman.
Apologize, I'm running late.
You're welcome. They've told, been told the rules.
Okay, is everybody signed in on the back? She's back there on the table. Okay, first case we're going to call is application 2016-01. Ms. Tracy? It's the Tracy show now.
Uh-huh. Apparently, Carmel and I just keep bumping the case back and forth between the city and county. And I told her that we don't have any cases for the April meeting, so tag, she's in.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm sorry I'm running late.
That's all right. They are looking to add about 23,000-24,000 square feet, bumping the total up to just a little over 61,000 square feet. Now, we have parking regulations in our LDR that addresses medical offices, maybe Valdosta Family Medicine, maybe Dr. Brunner's pediatric office. We also have regulations that address hospitals, such as SGMC. 2.5 spaces per bed. We really don't have anything that addresses a hybrid, such as something that offers inpatient outpatient almost as equally as they do inpatient work. They have currently 113 beds. They currently have 73 beds and 1.5 40. That would require them to have 283 beds. 283 parking spaces all total. They can provide 159 once all is said and done, once everything's done. research, feel that they're proposing 159 parking spaces does meet the intent of the ordinance, and that the ordinance is posing a hardship, not the applicant, because we really don't have anything for a hybrid such as Greenwood. So we evaluated it, looked at what we approved in 2012. They got a CUP for a psychiatric hospital in their zoning district. Also got an administrative variance for less than required parking. We looked at those approvals, found the same to be true about Greenwood being a hybrid, and recommend approval for 159 parking spaces. Any questions?
I have a question. The rationale behind 2.5 parking spaces per bed at the hospital is?
Visitors, doctors, things of that nature.
So for every patient in the hospital, there's potentially someone visiting them and a staff member taking care of them and half of someone.
Yes. And honestly, we look at something like SGMC, where maybe you have somebody in there who's having a baby, maybe you have somebody in there who's having surgery. You have a psychiatric hospital, mental issues hospital as well, where generally visitors aren't as prominent to Greenleaf, whereas they may be more prominent, more there at SGMC. So that needs to be our rationale.
Any other questions?
How did you come up with 4.5 for medical and dental offices?
We have a regulation in the parking regs that requires 4.5 spaces for every 1,000 square feet in a doctor's office, like the Office of Family Medicine or Dr. Broughton's dental office. If they were to build right this second, they would have to have 4.5 spaces for 1,000 square feet. They're not quite, Greenleaf isn't quite a doctor's office or clinic. They're not quite the conventional hospital. They're a mixture of both, if that makes sense.
I guess my concern was more for, even though they're adding 40 beds, and I read somewhere on here where they're, how many employees they're adding, usually the employee parking is more of a concern than the visitors. Just like I think at Valdosta Family Medicine, at one time they had to bus in employees, maybe park them somewhere else. And so that would be my only concern. How many, I'll ask them.
One thing I would like to say, we must work at Smith Northview Hospital, and it had about the same amount of beds there. With less parking. So, and it worked. That's one thing I just wanted to say.
Now, I will kind of bring this up. Mr. Hogan kind of brings up an interesting point. Greenleaf, when they went through their CUP in their administrative variance request in 2012, they were owned by SGMC. SGMC is an authority, which means technically they're exempt from our regulations. They didn't have to go through the CUP process. They didn't have to go through the minimum administrative variance, parking variance. But they were anticipating a sale and wanted to kind of make it right when they sold it, make sure that everything was clean, everything was conforming to the best of their ability, which is why they went through the processes they did before they sold. Right this second, Greenleaf is not owned by SGMC, and therefore they are bound to our regulations for business. If that makes sense.
It does. I think everybody should be afforded the same equal opportunity. Me personally.
Any other questions, any other discussions at this time? Thank you, Tracy. Is there anyone here who would like to give us any additional information from the applicant side? Anything that you don't feel like was brought to us that you want to present to us?
No, Tracy did a great job. My name is Will Crump. I'm with Crump Engineering. I'm the applicant on behalf of Greenleaf. And one thing I would like to add is that currently there are 73 beds, and they have 107 parking spaces right now, and they have plenty of parking for their current needs. And so with the 40 beds, you're adding another 52 spaces to bring it up to 159. And we feel from our experience and from the existing parking that they need on the site now, that it's 159 is more than adequate for this addition.
If I did my math right, it's right at two parking spaces per bed instead of two and a half. It went from one to... Okay, I'm sorry, I was using the wrong number. So it's actually about one and a quarter. About one and a quarter places per building.
Thereabouts.
You want me to answer your question?
Yes, I want to.
Because it helps remember that, you know, we're open 24/7.
Excuse me one second. Could I get your name and address?
Yeah. Stephen Register. I'm the CEO of Greenleaf Center.
Okay. And your address?
2209. My home address? Or
yes, your home address.
4106 North Lake Drive.
Thank you very much.
But to your point, so each unit will be a 20-bed unit. Initially, we'll start off with the first unit, but each unit will at least require per shift, which is we run about 12-hour shifts right now. And two nurses, two mental health techs, and a doctor, kind of throwing that in there. Now, we won't have to include as many doctors as we will nurses and techs because they have a certain amount of caseload. But you're talking about at least five per shift. So that when that shift goes off, another shift will come back on. So it's not 10 parking spaces for that. Does that clarify a little bit?
Anyone else from the applicant side would like to give us some information? Being that there appears nobody else here that might be in opposition, was there any contact to your office concerning this case?
Not even about the pretty red and white signs.
Okay. Anybody on board got any further questions or discussions? Can I get a motion on this request?
I make a motion that we grant a variance request on behalf of Crum Engineering to approve the 159 parking spaces.
Have motion on the floor to grant the request as presented. Do I have a second?
Second.
Have a second from Mr. Alvarado. All in favor, raise a hand. Unanimous. Good luck with it, gentlemen.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay.
Have a great day. Thank you.
Thank you. We have approval for minutes for January and February. Did anybody see anything we need to correct, add, delete?
Not February, December, and January.
I did notice that I did have a technical issue on the first page of the January 5th minutes that I had left the December template in, so I did take that out, put in January, and I didn't email out credit cards.
So I didn't think of
that.
Saw that. Thank you. Okay, I get a motion on the minutes. I have a motion. Second. Second, Ms. Porterman. All in favor, raise a hand. Unanimous. Thank you very much. Do we have any new business, any old business, anything we need to discuss? Carmella?
Sir, are you dangerous dead?
Apparently so,
from
the city
side
as well.
I did speak to Detective Shirley about the name badges. He told me what Chief Childress' suggestions were, and I was to speak to the city manager, which I did. And just me personally, I don't see what the big issue is. I feel like it was a big issue made out of name badges. It was brought to my attention that said the manager, he said that he didn't, I guess they're just nervous that we would misuse badges. That's a concern on the county's perspective and the city's perspective. But I was just like, you know, if we're able to make decisions here, how could we not make a positive decision to use a name badge properly? I honestly don't see what the big issue is about a name badge. I mean, it's too much time being put into a name badge. And I really don't see, is there any ordinance or anything pertaining to us having to go to the city manager or anything to get a name badge approved? I didn't see that anywhere.
There is no policy to my knowledge, one way or the other.
Yeah, I mean, I really think we're just being nice by going. I mean, honestly, I'm just being honest. I was going to get me a name badge printed up myself because and just give them the bill for it. Since it's such a big issue.
And honestly, how it happened, Chief Childress did give us the okay to provide the name tags for city members. And I got Mr. Hogan's information, emailed the picture of Chief Childress, and heard a day or two later that he had spoken to Mr. Hansen. And unfortunately, they had made the decision not to provide name tags. So given those circumstances, until I get further direction, them, the best I can do is a letter that says
to you all
for
purposes. Yeah. Well, the two obstacles that we're dealing with, and it's partly my fault because the very first time we talked about it, I used the nomenclature badge. And that turned everybody off in law enforcement because they don't want to give us a badge. But we should be calling it a name tag or an ID tag. But then they're still, city and county, they are concerned from a liability standpoint. Right or wrong, I can't answer for that, but that's one of the things that I have been told is they are concerned about the liability standpoint and why it would make it any more liable if we had a name tag or an ID tag than if we went without any ID. I don't know what the difference is. We're there for the same purpose, but nobody has explained to me from that standpoint. So right now, without further any further information, I guess it's sort of a dead duck.
Well, another thing I want to say is this, is that a situation happened like some years back with a meter reader guy. You know, he didn't have a badge, he didn't have any kind of forms of identification. Guy pulled a gun out of them. What did the city do or the county? They got name badges and they got orange vests. So how can that be your answer but not an answer for us? You know what I'm saying? I feel like there's too many people making too many decisions when it's a simple answer to the solution. See? To the problem, sorry. You know, that's why I say personally, no one else has to do it, but I'm gonna give them a name badge, man. We don't have to call a badge. I know I had a badge at the hospital. That didn't make me a police officer. See what I'm saying? And I told him that. He said, well, I don't know, y'all might decide to try to get free food with it. I don't know. I said, can you get free food by having a badge? He said, no. I said, well, how can you get free food, lad? He said, well, I don't know. I said, what you think we're going to buy medical marijuana with the badge? What you think we're going to do with it? You know, 25 cents. Office Max, Office Depot. At my house, print it up. I'm just saying, it really bothers me because it's such a simple situation for too many people to be involved. Did we get the sheriff involved with the county? No. We're just being nice about the situation.
The reason that the city did approach Chief Childress is because they are the ones who make our name tags. Planning and zoning doesn't have the equipment. Engineering doesn't. Health doesn't. Water and sewer doesn't. Parks and Rec doesn't.
And you know what? And I think that was probably pre-Office Max and Office Depot. You see what I'm saying? Because now we have those capabilities to do so. So now it's time to advance what we're doing and to make a simple solution for a difficult situation. You know?
I think there's an issue regarding semantics. I think I agree with Alan. When the word badge is thrown out,
they're hesitant, they're anxious. If it's just an ID with your picture on it,
that's no problem.
I mean, this is all issue semantics. They're just making a big deal out of nothing.
Great.
And in terms of, like, as an officer of the court, I see law enforcement abusing their badges every day.
And same here.
So, I mean, the fact that you got 21-year-olds that have a badge, you know, obviously abusing their power. I don't see anybody on this panel abusing any type of. There is no power associated with an ID.
Right.
That's the way I would address it.
Well, I don't know why we need a badge to begin with. I've always, when I've gone out to a place, if there was somebody, if there's a car there or whatever, I get out. I go up to the door, introduce myself. I have my papers in my hand where they can see their name on a piece of paper. This would not be a burglar or a robber, would not be carrying around something from the city or the county, whichever. They know who I am. They know what I'm there for. I look around. I have yet to meet one person that was not very accommodating once they know why you're there. And when they go before Tracy or Carmella, all they have to do is say there are going to be some people that will come out probably within 2 or 3 days of the hearing. Expect them because they're going to be looking at the property before they make a decision. Cut and dry.
In all honesty, you do what I do. Granted, the only difference is that I'm usually in a city car, but honestly, my city car is down the street sometimes. They're not looking at my city car because I parked it and I'm walking. I'm in a t-shirt and jeans. I've only had my ID for maybe a year, year and a half. So before that, you saw this in a t-shirt and jeans and tennis shoes. I went up, knocked on the door, introduced myself. Life was okay.
I will say this.
I see the point about having something to identify. I see Miss Nancy's point as well.
Yeah, and I see both, but I just think if you put both points together, you got the paper and the badge. You know, I mean, I think that solidifies the reason why you're there. You know,
let's not use badge. Let's use ID.
Let's use ID.
ID.
Yeah, your ID card.
ID is not threatening.
Yeah.
I use ID. I mean, ID rather than badge.
Yeah,
Because that's what I have an ID on.
Right, because I think we need to go to police badge when we say badge, right? Identification.
Okay. Well, at this point, it is not maybe totally dead, but it's not cooking very hard, and we will try to look one more time and see if there's anything we can do, whether they will reimburse us, which I wouldn't think they're going to be doing it, but if you wanted to get a tag made that had your picture on it and said, I left the Lowndes County ZBOA, I don't have a problem. I don't know that anybody else would have a problem if you have an ID.
Right.
But I don't know that they're going to reimburse us for it.
I mean, that's fine, but, you know, it's just that because I personally think they should, I give it to them. They don't have to reimburse it. That's fine. On a different standpoint, if I was them, I would. You know, it would be morally right.
In all honesty, Mr. Hogan, I see your point, but our standpoint is the man who signs my paycheck said no. And that's what I
have to provide. No, I understand your position. But I'm just saying on my position, that's why I can only speak for me. But yeah. Because I see a lot of different things than a lot of people see, you know, at night and during the daytime. If one person might be on one side of the spectrum, but I'm trying to give you the whole 360 degrees of the spectrum. So no matter how anybody feels, I'm speaking for the people, I'm speaking for myself and anybody else that don't have a problem with that, you know. I just don't want anybody to be blind to what they're seeing and saying, oh, yeah, it's not an issue, it's not a problem, maybe for some, maybe for others. But why not just create the whole spectrum and say, hey, nah, no problem, it's really no problem. You can get a badge at the darn gym. That's no problem. That's not saying you're a police officer when you walk in to go work out. I mean, an ID card, yeah, no problem.
Okay, move on. I think we need to move on. Starting to be a dead dog a little bit. Is there any other business we need to talk about? All right, we stand adjourned, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
So what are we saying about the class action?
Originally, we're going to make it a class action.
Actually, we didn't talk about it.
Well, then, if that one's settled, then there's someone else going to come through. Yeah. When that one gets...